back to back. Back and back and forth, I'm on the track. It's the literal jack of all and master of this passive act. I'm silent at the function, smack, chatting when I'm called to chat. Smiling, contemplating raps and living what I spit. It's that simple for me. I call the band together easily. We slide up on the beat and tee right off and off, then leave the piece disturbed. This heavy metal sea, we riding with the fiends and these and freezing geeks and Greendale human beings. I know what I need. I've been counting blessings, best to get to counting sheep. Mercy, mercy me. I've been up so long, pray I don't forget to sleep or forget to place that I was to get to places I'll be. See, freedom been the motivation since adjacent to them bodegas in the gas stations. Still impatient and sick of waiting for some cash payments, reparations from when they stole us. We making hits and we owe them. Your plate us until we go. Then no more cold nights, colder days in the city, hitting low lights. Start a day with the feelings, making waves out of nothing. It ain't nothing new, facing game with the stage through the roof. Yeah. The show, we next, we know when we on. Said we on, we on, we on. Till the street lights hit us. Shout out to the peace sound real us. You with us.
Ew. Girl, how you suckin' like that? No condom, fucking the track. And I made all these niggas my sons. In the booth every day back to back. Been shitting like I got the runs. Ew, messy. Your hoe tryna kick it like you know who. I got the green Gatsby, white hoe. Hey, Jesse. I hit it then bounce like Betty. No green in my account, Betty. Told me pull up to the Getty. Nah, cool. Straight to the. I need the ice at the bones. No Stanley, got a cup though. Got a cup of those. And my other jeans need black soap. You ain't up on clothes, I ain't gon' explain. Get my mama crib before I get a chain. Swear y'all niggas so bad. Word, putting this work to my back. Hurts. My whole game full of stackers. Bought this cheese, no packers. And we on, we on, we on. Shitting on you peons. Yeah, we on, we on, we on. We on, blues with me like Beyonce. Yeah, we on.
Cold nights, colder days in the city, hitting low lights. Start away with the feelings, making waves out of nothing. It ain't nothing new, facing game with the stage through the roof. Yeah. We at the show, we next, we know when we on. Said we on, we on, we on. Ride until the street lights hit us. Shout out to the peace sound real us. You with us.
We on, we on.
Who's iconoclast? Said again, when's the next project drop? If it's coming soon, don't worry about that. It's not coming out for me. Yeah, we see we got some more. Don't ask some questions, but I need some more questions. This nigga's in the gang, dude. Who's iconoclast? Said
there's something about the way you always talk to me. When you post like that, doing shows like that, something's in the way of where I wanna be. Please show me the way, I just need the way. I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you. Something seems to change up when you talk to me. Nothing stays the same, won't you play the game?
I can feel my heart on beat. Feeling so rapid, I reap no sleep. And the screen so bright, but at least you're alive. And I see your life for a brief sneak peek. See, I got some questions, hope you get answer them. Type them in jest and I'm blessed you respond. Tell us you're touring despite all your personal problems, cause fans ain't gonna love you tomorrow or even today. Look, I peep the hate on your page. Look, I read the pain in your face. Yeah, they gonna say what they say, but some shit ain't never gonna change. Yeah, I would kill to be where you sit, and it's love, but I hate to see how you been. I'm hoping I get to see you again, but I leave and don't get to see how it ends. Does it ever end?
There's something about the way you always talk to me. When you post like that, doing shows like that, something's in the way of where I wanna be. Please show me the way, I just need the way. I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you. Change up when you talk to me. Nothing stays the same,
yeah.
Won't you play the
time
game?
Won't slow, doesn't matter where I go. Never mind how I flow, yeah, I got my soul. But without it, I go pro, yep, straight to the league. I know this world's so cold. Heard this all before, heard us all for sports. Settling label scores, real life all the war. I just wanted more, I seen idols tip. I know stars are fall, we lost titans. I'm just human, is it worth fighting if I'm just losing? Ain't no light in this road I'm choosing. If I don't make it, then I just useless. Label fruitless, planting seeds in my spirit. On the wrong beat, I'm clueless. Time and time again, I just rhyme and vent till I find the right kind of muses. But look, I wanna be like you. I wanna ride in an all-white coupe. I wanna lie with a dime on the side and my eyes all wide from the poolside view. I want a life that I just can't hide from. I want likes and replies all true. I wanna fly where the sky's all blue. But I don't want lies to define my truth. You dig? You dig?
There's something about the way you always talk to me. When you post like that, doing shows like that, something's in the way of where I wanna be. Please show me the way, I just see the way. I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you, I wanna be like you. Something seems to change up when you talk to me. Nothing stays the same, won't you play the game?
Up to in this rap game right now. I don't look at nobody, bro. You feel me? I just pray every day, do my thing, do what I gotta do, handle my business. So, yeah, you feel me? I'm gonna get off this shit though. I gotta get back to work.
Thank you. relación interminable a Lolita Lebrón por la fiereza, por lo que han hecho de mí como animal terrícola, hembra americana, antillana, boricua, por lo que han hecho de mí como animal terrícola, americana, antillana, boricua.
Keep your sound on with your screen off and listen uninterrupted. Try YouTube Premium on us.
To the brink, my soul ain't sitting right, my heart ain't beating well or in sync. I get lost inside my thoughts when I think, got all my wisdom extinct. I'm just an artist when I'm rapping, activist to be linked. A nigga bored of the system that wants me dead or gone missing, and got me fed up existing. I throw my life in the ring just to feel something. I give anything to feel something. Now even stating what I like brings me anger, fear, and spite. I ain't lost, just a soldier with his helmet and his knife. Lost a rifle in his sight, I ain't pressed, just die. At my best when I'm more than normal, stressing through the night. I haven't known happiness since I was pushed, forced to see the light. I know I'm passionate, but that won't be enough to prove I'm right. Am I wrong if I'm questioning the methods of the fight? How much is my freedom worth if freedom free for whites? The men I thought would lead the show, they colors blue and pink. Corrupted by the substance capital, they ghoulish kink. Toss the goal aside and tore us down for Cuban links. Cause a nigga gon' be broke until the system broken. They show me why I stand with women while his fists were holding. Ain't satisfied till it's survivors that we give devotion. I hope you notice I've been focused on my actions mostly. And stepping back, lending space for those not in this for the boast. And I hear stomping in the street, will I rise or ride the beat? If my eyes are watching God, I find some solace on my feet. It's no more silence, not for me, let my conscience loose to speak. All these actions and words as intentional as can be, yo. We want revision, some niggas don't see the vision. Not begging for y'all to listen, but hold up, shift your pistons. They gearing up for a war and we're peering off in the distance. Fighting for revolution, you marching for recognition. What is it that you wanted? Decisions fall upon us to make so we can...
Hello, 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 and welcome, everyone. Welcome. It is so good to see all of you here. I just want to give a shout out to Nate Nix and Fabiola Mendez for playing us in tonight. Welcome to everyone. Just a little housekeeping before we begin. If you can please mute your mics, we would greatly appreciate it. And for those of you who are just coming in, know that we are recording tonight. So if you don't want your lovely face on screen, that is cool, but we just want you to know that we are recording. Hello, everyone. How y'all doing? How are we doing tonight? We doing all right? We feeling good? Yes? Well, welcome. Welcome. It is so good to see all of you here tonight. I'm glad that you all are safe or well and able to be here. My name is Chandra Mendez Ortiz. I'm the director, executive director of Artward Bound at Massachusetts College of Art and Design, and also co-director of Radical Imagination for Racial Justice. We have a fabulous, fabulous evening for you tonight, an evening of conversation, an evening of reflection, a real living room chat where we're coming into folks' homes, into your homes, and really dropping some knowledge tonight. So thank you so much for being here. Want to really get into the kind of space that we're going to be creating, and forgive me if I'm a little low energy. I'm still recovering from what we're all dealing with these past couple of years. So let me just walk it back a little bit, because we started this at the beginning, right before the pandemic started. So we started this program in 2020, and the program's called Radical Imagination for Racial Justice. We launched with a call to BIPOC artists, collectives, and creatives living and working in Boston. We co-created a community process, and 16 artists and collectives formed, and they are the inaugural cohort, all of which were here tonight to kind of share their practices with us. Throughout 2021 and going into 2022, artists and collectives work to bring their collective visions for racial justice in collaboration with their communities to life. We all know that through COVID, through the pandemic, you know, the game has changed. We've all been impacted. And to really think about how to live our lives with wellness at the core, with joy as purpose, is that hard and meaningful work that all of our artists were charged to do. And I think they did it with grace and style and real meaning and substance. So those real themes that artists were grappling with this year were these big ideas of radical imagination, racial justice, community collaboration, wellness, and joy. Tonight, as I mentioned, is about reflection. Together, several of the artists, collectives, and code builders of the RARJ program will reflect on a tapestry of interwoven themes, processes, resources, response and responsibility, balance, and community wellness, and more. Stories from this process of bringing to life our visions of racial justice in collaboration with our communities. Tonight is also a celebration. It's a celebration of all of the artists and everyone who is a part of the RARJ journey. So with that being said, I want to give a special thanks to everyone who's here and even the folks who couldn't be with us tonight. This is a labor of love over these last 2 years, this very big community-driven process. Everyone from the RARJ advisory group, the street team, our community-based panel and panelists, Dunamis for their technical and facilitative support, Perpetual Hayfron for all of the support that she gave to artists, Zinlin Hang for our virtual exhibition. We also want to thank all those involved in this important partnership and collaboration, Mass Art, the Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture, City of Boston, and the Serdna Family Foundation. We give thanks to this whole big community who really made manifest this journey that we're on tonight. So now I want to thank and welcome our co-hosts, and also they were there at the very beginning of this whole process wearing lots of different hats. Karen and Shravina, two incredible artist humans in our community, RARJ co-builders and co-architects. We welcome you to begin to grab, you know, wrap your arms around the community and welcome people into the space and start our session tonight. Karen, Shravina.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Welcome, welcome. Welcome, Shravina.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome, Karen. Glad to be here again. Welcome to everyone.
Excellent. Really excited to do this with you and welcome everyone into the space. Yes. Welcome all of us gathering right here, right now. We're going to start with a ritual we crafted with one of our very own RIRJ artists who couldn't be here tonight, Mika Rose, with the teachings by Alexis Pauline Gums, Ty DeVoe, Bell Hooks, Ray Valmoris, Salinas, and many, many others.
Yes, so without further ado, let's begin. I would like everyone to feel free, get in a comfortable position, listen to your body, your mind, your heart, and your soul. And in beginning, let's share three breaths together, listening to our bodies and feeling the earth beneath us and the air around us. Breathing in.
And breathing out, welcoming air in,
and welcoming air out. And finally, one more breath,
and out.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for being you. Thank you for being here with us, and thank you for breathing into presence with us.
Yes, and as we bring ourselves here, let's give thanks to the people who make our presence possible. We invite you to call in all lineages, your ancestors, your descendants you carry with you tonight. In my presence today specifically, I carry in the healing presence of my ancestors. And in the chat, please feel free to share who you bring in with you to this Zoom meeting today, and we'll be there facilitating.
So for me, my lineage, I think of my mother, Susan Doreen Wong, and my grandmother, Phyllis Wong. I bring them in with me. Thank you for sharing some things in the chat, if you do. And thank you for all of the who's that you are bringing with you tonight. In gathering, we want to honor that we're not in neutral space. We're not in neutral time. My friend and fellow artists and residents for the city, Erin Jinya, declares us in a state of cultural emergency. We are born into a dominant culture that uses war, borders, slavery, and more violences to keep us from good relations with each other and this planet. But as poet June Jordan reminds us, our generations and generations of revolutionaries show us we are the ones we've been waiting for.
Yes, indeed. In our collective work of imagination, access to remember where we are, where we have been, face how we are now, and expand who we have become together. Imagination is abundance work. Rage is our work, rest is our work, burning down is our work, joy is our work, and responsibility for one another is our work. We counter worlds of harm every day by growing galaxies of love.
Galaxies of love. And we're here. Totant, Turtle Island, Abya-Yala, generations of people, including Massachusetts, Nipmuc, Wampanoag, and Pawtucket, steward these land waters across many tongues. As we tend to the traumas that shape our diaspora, may we turn towards each other, challenge each other with care, and honestly ask, how do we build an us? How do we build a we?
Let's wrap it all up. Let's breathe together once more, honoring chi, mana, soul, however we name the energies, the source that fuels our trying, failing, learning, trying again and again and again. Breathing in.
And breathing out.
Okay. So just wanted to thank everyone for your presence tonight, you know, as we welcome you and you welcome yourselves into this space. So today's event will be a conversation, a collaboration, an up close and personal look into the RIRJ experience. As we welcome our RIRJ artists to the sacred circle, this conversation will be an hour and a half long with a short break. And the chat will be open for any questions, comments, or concerns. And we'll be sure to facilitate them as we go along.
I like what I'm seeing in the chat. So please, we encourage you to use the chat for comments and questions, as Sharina was saying. We're gonna begin with some introductions, but before that, I just wanna remind everyone we are recording the session. So if you don't wanna be recorded, please feel free to turn off your cameras. And also closed captioning is available. You can hit the button down below, the live transcript. And for accessibility purposes, we're going to be stating our name before we speak so that we can be accessible for folks with visual impairments. And so while we won't be conducting formal presentations, we did want to give each person here, and we're going to have time for each artist, but also our hosts and Ceci here from our core team to introduce themselves. So without further ado, I would like to kick it off to the folks from the Unbound Bodies Collective, Bashezo and Kamaria.
Thank you, Karen. This is Kamaria, they, them pronouns.
Bashezo, Zizir, and they, them pronouns. Hello, everyone.
We're from the Unbound Bodies Collective. We're 2 out of 5 of the members. And our project was Roots and Futures. We are the ones we've been waiting for. And that's a quote from June Jordan. Do you want to share a bit more about Roots and Futures?
So Roots and Futures was an exploration and a practice in honoring Blackness, Black queerness, our elders, our Black queer elders in the Boston metro area, as well as our Black trans, gender non-binary contemporaries. Who we called our icons in this project as a way to give flowers while people are alive, as a way to celebrate and recognize and see one another with love and care while we are alive, knowing that no day is guaranteed, but that we can be here together. And it was such an honor and a pleasure to learn more about Boston's queer history as well as what's to come.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it was really beautiful to be able to do that in public. That was a part of the practice, was to really reveal what honoring Black, queer, and trans community members looks like in public. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's hard to explain in words. I hope that you enjoy seeing the images here and online. So without much further, I will pass it off to Ceci Mendez-Ortiz. Thanks.
Thank you, Bashizo and Kamaria. My name is Ceci Mendez-Ortiz. My pronouns are she, her, hers. And I want to start by sharing that I am Moises and Yolanda Mendez's daughter, and they are my heart. They are here tonight. Hi, mom and dad. And they are the foundation of all that I know about community, art, learning, and justice. I'm an artist and an arts and culture worker, so I get to dream and create with a phenomenal team of women in Mass Arts Center for Art and Community Partnerships, Elena, Equa, Carolyn, and Isabel. And together we partner with people and communities within and beyond Mass Art to radically expand access to transformative creative experiences. I'm also co-director of Radical Imagination for Racial Justice with the phenomenal Chandra and Cara Elliott Ortega. So thank you much, happy to be here. And now here's Phoebo.
Hello, everybody. My name is Phoebo, he, him. I am one half of Adobo Fish Sauce. My other partner in time is Ricky Oring, and he sends love from wherever it is that he is, wasn't able to be here tonight. Our project was called Recipes for Racial Justice as Adobo Fish Sauce. We combine our two loves, spoken word poetry and cooking and food and all the things that are necessary to fill a belly. And we had our project in two phases. The first one was a workshop phase where we collaborated with another organization, I Learn America, and worked with two Boston public schools, Boston International Newcomer School and Horace Mann for the School of the Deaf and Hard of Hearing. And then we cooked up some recipes and took those recipes and turned it public facing and had a second half of our project called In the Park. And you guessed it, we were in a couple of parks hanging out, eating some food, talking some trash and having a good time. I am excited to hear from Hussein. Talk to us.
Thank you, Phoebo. Hey everyone, my name is Hussein. I use they, he pronouns, and I was the program coordinator for Games for Justice. Games for Justice was an 8-week summer program for youth of color in the Boston area to participate in a collaborative, anti-racist, transformative justice game studio. And next I'll pass to the amazing Karen.
Hello, hello again. My name is Karen Young. I use she, her pronouns. I'm a cultural organizer, teaching artist, and taiko player. As an artist, I'm really curious about what happens when somebody hits the drum with these big sticks. And I particularly am passionate about community engagement and public art. And one of my main projects is working with Black and Brown elders from Grove Hall Senior Center and Dorchester. And I served as an advisory on the advisory council. Really pleased to play a role in backing and cheerleading this project, and as a panelist reviewer. So happy to be here tonight. Passing it on to Mariona.
Hi everybody, my name is Mariona Lloreta, she, her pronouns. I work in film, painting, and dance. And I'm a proud new mother as of exactly 1 month ago. My work explores themes of identity, spirituality, collective memory, and my RIRJ project is called Alters, and it's basically twofold. On one hand, I directed and produced an experimental short film that examines the aftermath of police brutality in a young family. And parallel to this, I produced an interdisciplinary event that spotlighted extraordinary BIPOC artists in Boston. So I'm so happy to be here in conversation with you all, and I'll pass the word to Shervina.
Hi again, everyone. I'm Shervina Geraldo. If you don't know from the intro, now you know. I'm a student panelist. I'm currently a senior in Artwork Bound in Sony International, and I'm also a multimedia artist. A lot of my artwork, well, as of lately, has been centered around self-growth and, you know, spirituality, especially as an Afro-Caribbean American woman. Things such as joy and happiness being a Black woman and coming into my youth as I'm 17, going on 18, kind of like that shift from teen to adulthood. So yeah, that's how, what my, a lot of my work has been focusing on as of lately, but I've also had a passion when it comes to racial justice, especially in a city such as Boston and being an inner city youth, seeing things such as injustices, especially within the school system. So I've had the pleasure of being on the RIRJ street team and then became a panelist. And now I am here once again, emceeing for this amazing event and being with these amazing artists, seeing everyone's beautiful work and seeing everyone's beautiful faces. So yes, happy to be here. I'm going to pass it on to Silvina.
Hello, everybody. My name is Silvina. I am a visual artist and an expressive art therapist, a musician. I play the guitar. And my project was a paper theater project. This project created spaces, little stages of radical imagination for the BIPOC community. I worked with an amazing group of BIPOC women in the South and in Boston, where they created the stories through these stages. And the project was about creating the spaces where you can express your own stories and share them with the community. So it was an honor to witness the process and being part of this project. So I will pass now this on Nate.
Word. How's it going, everybody? My name is Nate. I'm a recording artist. I'm a recording artist from Roxbury in Boston, you know what I mean? I also rep Grove Hall, you feel me? That's where all my people are from. So shout out to Grove Hall, shout out to Roxbury. My project was the Radical Cypher series, also known as If I Could Change You. And this project really allowed myself and the young people that I was around to create space for us and other young people from BIPOC communities to share our stories in an environment that we were able to construct of our own. So it was a great pleasure of mine, not only to be able to like work with these young folks, but also to be able to help them step into themselves as artists and be able to share their stories and their the things that they've experienced to an audience of their peers. So I was really excited. And quick fact, I was the last person in like the row, so I'm not passing it to anyone, you know what I mean? Locked in.
Excellent. This is Karen. Thanks, Nate, for that last introduction, and thanks to everyone. We're going to kick off our discussion right now. And to do that, we're going to spotlight all of us. And when we designed this event, we really wanted to create this homey living room conversation where we were digging deep into some of our reflections from this last year. With Shervina and I also participating, having been on the advisory group and street team, really looking at what happened this year. And Ceci's here as well as a core team member. So we invite you to make comments in the chat if you agree, if you have questions. We'd like to vibe off of you as well. And just again, a reminder that we are recording, so you can turn off your camera if you don't want to be recorded. And again, a reminder to our panelists here, our living room conversation, to speak slowly, clearly, and introduce your name, please, as well, for those who are with us who for accessibility issues. So with that, I'd like to kick it off with the first question, which is, we're not doing formal presentations, but what happened and how was it different from what you imagined would happen?
Word. So I'm Nate again. I think one of my expectations going into working on this project was that everything would be relatively straightforward. In my work as a program coordinator at the Center for Teen Empowerment, I work with young people like all the time. And so usually like there are like bumps in the road as far as getting things done, but we're always able to like navigate through things, mostly because that's like a nonprofit organization that has like a pool of funding to be able to like, you know, push towards stuff. So working as like an independent artist in this, on this particular project, working to like not only like pay the young people that I was working with for their work, but also like meet with them on my own like personal time, was definitely a challenge. You know what I mean? All of our schedules were aligned in a very, I'll say, interesting way. Sometimes they didn't always align. But one of the things that I definitely thought was to a benefit of us is that we were all very committed to the project. And so over time, regardless of like our schedules, folks were working on things, you know, outside of the spaces that we held together. And I think that really helped us pull things together in the end. But I definitely didn't expect, or I didn't foresee that challenge arising where we wouldn't be able to meet as frequently as I wanted to. And also just like, yeah, the way that working outside of an organization as an independent artist, as far as bringing other people in, can be difficult. I didn't expect that. So, yeah, I'll open the space for anyone else that wants to respond.
Wow, so many things happened that I didn't expect, that we didn't expect. As one of the leads for the project, I'm supposed to say my name, my bad. Bashizo, Zizir, they, them. One of the things that I didn't anticipate was all the cat herding and the like admin work of, you know, getting 20, 30 people together, even at different points in time, like how much time and energy and frustration that took. But, you know, regardless of the kind of like cat herding that we had to do once we were actually in space, whether that be Zoom space or in public space or creating creative space together or all of the above, what happened was so magical and beyond what I had and even imagined or thought was possible when I was writing the grant. And to hear like the richness and to feel the richness of the stories and the longings and the conjurings and the connections that so many people had, some knowingly and some unknowingly, how they unfolded throughout this year was quite stunning and really humbling, as well as, you know, we thought this was going to be like a year project. This is probably going to be kind of like one of Unbound Bodies' life's work, and can continue to go on for years, and was also not expecting that as well.
And this is Kamaria. I'm gonna add to that about a couple of things about process. I think what we originally, the model was excellent actually in collaborating with elders and with contemporary queer Black folks. We, in order to design the altars, we held like Kiki sessions where we just hung out online in Zoom. They were supposed to be in person and then ended up being in Zoom, COVID safe. But what that ended up doing was open up these portals between our living rooms. So we're actually in each other's homes in ways that I don't know if we would have initially if we first met each other. And for some of these Kiki sessions, they were first meetings. So it was like a kind of instant intimacy within the frame. And that's one of the things that we also invited of folks is to share what they felt comfortable with. And some folks did that visually, just like the room they picked to meet with us, or by the next meeting they'd like bring a picture with them. And so it was kind of like this layering of intimacy that was really interesting in terms of relationship building time. But in terms of the linear admin time, when you think that like, oh, I'm just gonna add like a couple more meetings to my life, and we all have we all have different versions of day jobs or a couple of projects, day jobs. It actually feels more like exponentially more time and not just like a couple more hours. So by the end of our project, the exhaustion was wild, like much more than we thought, even with trying to pace ourselves to buffer time. And we still, like Bashi said, like figured out that, and maybe that was the point too, is that we're in a continuum of work. We're not in like a linear, even like a year. By the end of the year, we're like, what is a year? What is a year in COVID time? Like, what is, you know, all these questions of time and also relationality came up. And I think the process was just showing us that things about relationships are actually more like spirals. And sometimes those things like interconnect, like when we were in a Kiki session with one elder, they brought up a space, Elites, which is like a really old Black disco site in Roxbury that used to be in Nubian Square in the 80s for a really brief period of time, as most like gay and lesbian clubs only have lifespans. Yeah, especially Black folks of color, like those clubs like only have lifespans of like a couple of years. But a couple of elders in separate kikis were talking about having these like body changing experiences there, like life altering, like experience of love in a way that felt like authentic, true, and like a surprise. And we were like, damn, I can relate to a dance floor, you know? And also, damn, I didn't know we had like a Black gay club in the middle of Nubian Square, like back in the day. Like, I wanna know that, you know? So I think there's just complexities and richness that like you cannot account for in a project proposal, but that actually happen when you have like really good relationship kind of like building process models to work with that are simple. They don't have to be complicated.
And before, I have one little anecdote. This is Bashizo again. We had one elder share with us that she went to this club looking for a cheating man. And instead she found herself because she went into the club and she met who was going to be her future partner. And that shit was like, phew. So I'm gonna leave y'all with that.
Leave with that.
Who else has a process stories? Don't we all?
Phoebo, here of a Double Fish Sauce. One of the practices that Ricky and I tried to implement into our work and then invited other people into our work this time was this idea of process as product. Like if we can document our process well enough that within itself can serve as the product. And that was harder than we thought. That was harder than we thought it was gonna be. Primarily because, or at least for the grant writing process, we were like, all right, we can't just say that we're gonna figure it out with the young people, which is what we wanted to do. We wanted to figure it out with the young people, but in order to like at least have somewhat of a direction, we had to think of a lot of different ways that it could end up. And I think we came up with a list of like 7 or 8 different things. We ended up doing like 2 of them. And it's just because that's exactly, it ended up being exactly what we thought it was gonna be, but we just didn't, when it was happening, we didn't realize that what we thought was gonna be what was gonna be. We wanted the process to be built with the young, with the folks and with the scenarios that were there, and allowing it to come up naturally. And the more and more that we tried to be like, yeah, but what about this idea of a cookbook? Or what about the idea of this? They were just like, that's cool, but that is not where we are at. And so listening to that was something that we found ourselves needing to do more and more. And the more that we allowed ourselves to listen to that, the easier things became, because we were like, we need to stop fighting the very thing that we spoke into existence. We wanted this to be a process-driven situation. We need to follow the process of where it goes, even if it isn't where it is that we thought it was going to. So, you know, that's it.
I'll hop on here. Mariona, and things that you all mentioned really resonate, actually. My project is a film, and the film industry is pervasively white cis male dominated to this day. So I wanted to be super intentional with who came on board this project, both in front and behind the lens. So I tried to find an all female identified crew and an entirely BIPOC cast. And I don't think I realized how difficult that would be without leaving Boston, basically, and the confines of the city, and make sure it was local talent that was uplifted. We filmed in May 2021. So we were also, like all of you, dealing with the exhaustion of the pandemic, heavy climate due to police brutality. And I think attempting to make a film that deals with the issue of police brutality requires an effort, especially for BIPOC folks, that's more challenging in these times, right? So we had tons of last minute cancellations, really bad difficulties communicating throughout. And everybody really put their best foot forth. Everybody wanted to be there, but everybody was dealing with so much that it was kind of a fine dance between your heart and your ability and your bandwidth at the time. So I think that was something that I was anticipating, but I think it surprised me how kind of all encompassing it was throughout the process. So yeah, that would be one thing. But that being said, I think that team wise, we prioritized some considerations. Like I wanted to fairly compensate all members of my cast, like Nate mentioned, and the crew for their time and work, and basically try to be as accommodating with whatever they needed as possible. Story-wise, we wanted to approach the story from a lens of gentleness and celebration and honoring the beauty and complexity of it instead of kind of adding more trauma to the narrative. Logistically, we tried to prioritize like proper feeding, like good food, you know, and like proper pauses throughout, which is, I wanna say, rare in, especially in independent filmmaking. You know, scheduling each member and their block of acting or service as efficiently as possible to not overexhaust, you know, folks, et cetera. So I think those are also celebrations and things that we were able to achieve, I wanna say, and it was a success despite all the challenges. So my two cents on that.
I can go. Silvina here. Many things happened during the project, which were a joy for me to experience, because one of the things that happened, I expected that during the process of the making, of creating these stages with the community, people maybe wanted to express the stories that they had to share regarding COVID-19, isolation, and or maybe trauma, I don't know. But I thought about that. But what happened was that people brought things that they had in their hearts. So many of the participants were from the same community, but they didn't know about each other in the way that they were able to share during the process. So this part of creating community through something fairly unusual, because many people doesn't know what is a paper theater, or some people think that is a childish thing, or maybe it's like puppetry, or but we co-created these boxes, spaces. It was create a space, it was creating time. So I resonate with Bashizo and Kamaria, because these stories with this spiral time, and I threw that on the chat, instead of the chronos, which is the chronological time, what happened that we invited to kairos, which is the cyclic time of the storytelling and sharing in the circle with the community. Again, another circle on the table. So that was unexpected to me, to us, and it was wonderful to witness. And it happened at two levels. First, we have shared, after we created the stages, we had like the small sharing time with the community and participants, which was profound, very personal. And the second level was we had like an exhibition with the community. It was like in times of COVID-19, so we didn't have a lot of people. We follow all the COVID-19 protocols, but even though that, atmosphere that we shared during the exhibition was something completely different that I expected. And I think that everybody and some of the people that was able to express and share their experiences, they said exactly the same. And another thing is, I had always on mind that this is it's an ongoing work, right? It's not about the project. It's like a commitment, a life commitment to work with communities, to know that sometimes we are channels of many things, that sometimes we are facilitators, sometimes we are in the middle of the circle living and experiencing exactly the same as others. This amazing opportunity, I feel so grateful for being here and for being part of this amazing cohort, because I learned a lot about others and about the other projects and how many things we have in common, right, in these times, right?
I think I'll also add a little bit. So for me, I think initially when I started the project, Hussein, he, they, or they, he, either. For me, when I started off, it was really important for me to understand how to bring anti-capitalism into the structure of Games for Justice. And I think that was something that I was sort of thinking about for a long time. And I think I ended up sort of replicating the classic like nonprofit structure without intending to, because I had sort of, but I'm paying young people this amount, I had kind of already set the budget, right? And sort of just like without thinking, done the same things that I had seen and growing up, right, in the orgs that I had been a part of, without being like, pause, you know, like, let's actually interrupt that and figure out how to do that differently. And I think I really wanted to complicate the relationship between like payer and payee more, to be more than that, to make it a little bit more democratic. But I think I had just ended up spending so much time on curriculum, thinking like, oh, all the justice pieces need to be in the curriculum and not expanding beyond that. So I feel like that's something I really wish I had paid more attention to. And in the future, I definitely want to focus more on. Let me think, what else? There was also, as always, like, I think I never anticipate the power of like the vulnerability of art making together in a group. I think when I started the summer, I was like, so nervous, like all these young people, I don't know any of them, hope they're gonna like the space. And then by the end, there was like so much love in that room when we were closing out that I didn't even expect. I don't know why every time whenever I close out a summer with young people, I'm like, I didn't expect like this much love, or like, yeah. And I think I'm quickly learning to never underestimate like people's capacity to open their hearts to that, to those kinds of processes. So I'm really grateful for that, yeah.
Share a little bit. It's really beautiful to hear in this living room. All of your reflections are reflections on process and you know, how we plan, as if plans can actually become PLANSs. You know, in so many ways through our conversations throughout this past year plus, there are so many ways that the co-creation and the building and the bringing to life of what Radical Imagination for Racial Justice as a regranting program could be in Boston, there are so many ways in which the process of this project mirror or feel in resonance and in spirit and holding hands with so many of the challenges and the both the expected unexpecteds and then also like the beautiful surprising blessings And also the hard stuff, right? Like what one of the things I so appreciate about having this conversation together is that so often in presentations, it's like the sexy highlight or, you know, like the polished result, you know, the great thing that happened, but kind of looking under the covers or under the hood or behind the scenes and being able to be really honest and acknowledge how hard this work can be, whether it is about like, you know, a couple of you have mentioned, like when we open our hearts and we are addressing trauma, which is not everything we're reacting to. We were proactively building worlds, but trauma is there. And how do we build the worlds that we want to see? What are we reacting from? We're coming with all of it. And I'll just say that, you know, there was a piece of this that, especially for those of us at MassArt, it was a unique experience because there was also the dynamic of, you know, we had this opportunity to connect with CERDNA and, you know, bring these resources to Boston and create this program, and also had to kind of rally and deal with what it meant to be a re-grantor, like, and deal with the power dynamics of what that meant, whether we liked it or not, you know. And I'll just say with us, you know, in some of our cohort meetings throughout the year, sometimes leaving those and realizing like, we're kind of the man, like we have this money and they see us like that. And just being really real about that and accepting that and you know, navigating these very complex spaces. And also just wanna shout out a deep, deep appreciation to all of us here on this, on the call and all of the artists who are in our cohort, who are listening in or watching in and, because your feedback along the way, the constant and continual, and I hear this in your stories too, the need to pivot, the need to adapt, the need to listen, and then also the responsibility to respond. And it speaks to like that exponential piece, Kamaria, that you were talking about, because it's rarely does 1 + 1 = 2. It's usually like 1 + 1 = 100,024,037.5. So I'll stop with that, but just really appreciate this conversation.
I'm cracking up about being the man because as a reviewer, you know, you do have the power. You know, as someone who was on the advisory council, you are someone who helped craft the RFP. And I don't know how you felt, Shervina, but you know, it's like, community-based artists, you know, like young people, students were part of this process. And so, you know, the big question we're asking ourselves is how do we like decolonize, what does it mean to decolonize this process? Like, can we, you know? And, you know, when we were considering like having submissions be video or audio, not necessarily being worried about grammar and like, you know, how the language looked or how it came out, but really kind of trying to feel for the ideas. You know, it took way longer to have a process like that, because, you know, when you're wanting to really hold space for someone who does like a video or audio recording, you need to like really take notes so that you can really, you know, think about that as well as somebody who did something in writing. And yeah, I think it was like, I don't know, felt like 1 + 1 = 2. It was many, many, many more hours and, you know, huge responsibility, you know? I was also invited to consider applying and I was like, well, I need to choose one role or the other, but it was also like, you know, how do we make this really be as equitable and fair as possible?
Any other thoughts on process or I don't want to put folks on the spot, so. Yeah, I see you, Bashizo.
Bashizo. One of the things that also one of the many kind of realizations and emergent things that came up was like, I wrote the grant like thinking about these like living altars and that being the primary way in which we celebrated people's lives and tended to their needs and their creative like dreams and ephemera of life. And that was beautiful. But it was also like the little things. It was the flowers when something unexpected happened. It was the sending meals when folks didn't have like food coming in. It was like talking to folks like outside of this project and, you know, if something came up and them hitting us up and sharing a little bit. Like I got to know this one elder who, you know, we're still to this day kind of like phone buddies. And as someone who's like kind of chronically ill and kind of housebound, like how important just that type of connection became, and that she didn't really want the altar. Like that wasn't necessarily like what she wanted and needed to like feel connected and seen, was just something so basic as like, if you're thinking about me, hit me up. And if I'm thinking about you, let me do the same. And let me learn about, and she, this one particular elder was like, I won't tell you anything until you tell me something too. And I was all like, word, okay, yeah. What do you want to know?
Yeah.
And so it was, again, blurring that line, not only between like who is who, but that this was like a process for us all to kind of emerge and move closer together and to learn about one another, and to hold one another. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, when we started the process, we really thought, and I really thought about it in really like concrete ways, but it was really like these really small, tender moments that were quite like so, so moving, that really did kind of become the fascia that held the bigger, flashier stuff, the things that we took pictures of together, but it wouldn't, without that net of like care and recognition and reciprocity and mutuality and curiosity, none of those pictures could have even happened without that vulnerability and that willingness to explore and experiment with one another and open up to one another.
I'm gonna step to the floor. So for me, I think in terms of like process, I'd kind of like really want to highlight, you know, transitioning from the street team all the way over like to the panel group, because that was like a really big, like a really big change for me. You know, and I guess in a way it will kind of like talk about my experience with like self-growth, but also seeing this project as growth and seeing all like, you know, the beautiful artists and their projects grow all together. So I think one thing I would like to highlight about like, you know, everything, this entire process up till now, was like growth was a big thing, and even growth that I didn't think I would ever see in myself. Like, you know, I kind of started off in the street team, like, you know, really kind of shy, timid, like sophomore, you know, like, but I knew I was very passionate about like, you know, radical imagination. I knew I was passionate about racial justice. Like those times that I didn't really say much, but those times that I did say much, it had a lot to do with things such as, you know, racial justice and things pertaining to inner city youth. So, you know, those circles and like those meetings when we transitioned to Zoom, like with the street team, how we had these conversations being held, it was, I think, just shifting from that and then shifting to like, you know, the big work, like working with panelists, working with other artists, like not working with a like really small circle, but now working with people from all around Boston. It was like, okay, Vina, you can't keep having people telling you to speak up. Like now you got something to say, now it's time for you to say it. So like in a way, just seeing myself grow, seeing like, you know, how this project itself in itself has come so far was something that like you know, it was really a process. And on it, it's so strange. It's like a process that I didn't even see until now. It's like before, I remember, you know, Perpetual like kind of like coaching me, like, okay, like try to go slow as you speak. And now I'm just like, or like, you know, step to the mic or something like that. And now it's like even an Artwork Bound, and like even in like conversations such as these, like, you can't get me to shut up. Even in the classroom, can't get me to shut up. Like, okay, should be on one mic, okay, should be on, let the other person talk. And I think it's just beautiful to see, and it's beautiful to see, like, you know, how we've all like come so far with our projects and with our creative practice. So I think that process in its own is like, it's still a process, I would say, because we're still ever changing. I'm still ever changing. You know, I went from learning how to speak up to learning how to not speak, but which is not something that I'm gonna learn. I'm not gonna get used to that. But yeah, you know, we're here, and it's beautiful, you know.
Yeah, Shervina. This is Karen. I'm just going to throw out the next question, and also, you know, feel free to ask each other questions too, if you want to bounce off of this one, or you have others. But what does it mean to balance the surge of capacity with the responsibility to community that comes with the new resources and money of the grant? Were you pushed to expand your scope or size, or even go beyond capacity?
I can jump in just because I think that's an interesting question. It's kind of like, I guess maybe like that balance is something that I'm still like learning. Because as far as like capacity goes, I think like, I don't know, I'm an artist, you feel me? So I think a lot of times I'm willing to like put my art like before like my own like well-being in different ways, which is like, don't do that. That's not good, you feel me? But I think as I like continue to like learn and grow as an artist, that's something that I'm like becoming more like aware and cognizant of. And for this project in particular that I worked on, like this summer was like hectic, you know? I wanted to make sure that I had the opportunity to not only like engage with these young people as almost like a mentor, but I also had like this project to keep in mind. It was like, yo, we got to get this done. You feel me? So if we're not like doing what we need to do, then it's, I don't know, it's going to be like difficult for us to like continue to like have opportunities like this in the future. And so to me, that was like difficult. Like that was a difficult kind of like reality to grasp, because what it showed me was that like no matter what type of environment you wish to create, like as long as there's like funding behind it, like there's always going to be kind of like expectations. And I think that to me was like difficult, but I think it's also like a very valuable lesson. One thing that I definitely want to like emphasize as far as this idea of like the balance between like capacity and like responsibility to the community is that I never put like that expectation on the young people. That like we needed to get this done. Otherwise we'd be like letting the community down. You know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, like we're all community members. And I think our responsibility to our community is for us to like find like opportunities for joy and like for ourselves to like thrive in different ways, right? Because if we're not able to find those things, then how can we expect the community to find them at the same time? It's difficult. It's like that ideology where it's like, you can't care for others if you're not first taking care of yourself. That was something that we definitely like harped on. Like it was almost like something that we said every time. It was like, how are you doing today? It's like, I'm not asking that because it's like, oh, like I want, like I'm just asking, I'm asking because I want to make sure that you're doing okay, because we have responsibilities to ourselves and to our community right now to make sure that we're okay first. But again, like that's something that's difficult when there's like money involved and when there is like an expectation or deadline even involved. Because you miss the deadline, then it's like, oh no, I don't know. It's gonna be difficult to even like move forward with stuff like this in the future, like I said. So it was definitely difficult finding that balance, but I think right now it's something that's on the forefront of my mind. It's like wanting to continue to get better at balancing for sure.
No, I wanted to jump in on what you said, Nate, because like when you said, you know, I don't want to put this on the young people that I'm working with, I don't know, something immediately like resonated with me about that. And then also it's kind of difficult because then, like you're saying, in the back of your head, you're still applying that to yourself. You're right, like if I don't get this done, like I'm failing my entire community. If I don't get this done on this particular day at this minute, like putting so much pressure on yourself. And I think that like not putting it on young people doesn't actually solve the root of the problem, because it's like, if I saw my people a generation up for me doing that, and I, again, like I said earlier, like repeated the same structure when I was making Games for Justice, right? Because I didn't take time to question it. I feel like that kind of trickles down a little bit without you even intending to. And so sometimes it's, the hardest thing is to actually be like, I have to apply this to myself. Otherwise young people are gonna see stuff that I think that I'm hiding well enough, right? Like I'm working on this alone and I'm pushing myself really hard and hopefully, you know, it's not, I don't know, whatever. Sorry, also Hussein, I keep forgetting that. I will remember, I promise. Yeah, so we need to apply that to ourselves.
I just want to uplift the question that in the chat was what, maybe at some point someone would answer, like, what would you now redefine what radical means to you?
I think I would, if we're talking about radical care or we're talking about like a radical reimagination, I think what's interesting, what was interesting about this grant and this proposal was that we actually had to articulate what our wellness plan was going to be. So instead of being like, yeah, we'll do some, like, we'll do self-care on the side, like we actually had to, as a collective, share with each other in like a more planful and direct way. And I think that that and we had already, like, in a collective, we're also like friends and we're family in a way, and we're like, you know, like queer chosen fam. And so we already have practices of care, but as we experienced COVID and we're like, oh, now we have to come into pods, we need to like really figure out like what that pod work is. And a lot of that was like boundaries, risk assessment, and being able to communicate that and communicate it like up to the moment, which was really nerve-wracking for some of us, especially since even if in our collective we already had practices of like care and appreciation, sometimes outside of the collective we didn't have that. Like we expressed something and someone pushed back on the boundary, or someone was like risk assessing COVID differently, and then so it didn't. Yeah, so I think there was a really interesting moment of when I'm thinking about radical care, it's actually not radical. Like when I think, okay, radical by definition is like the root, like what is at the root of something. And so I don't even think we've gotten to the depths of that yet. I think like out of COVID, and I'm talking about like US cultural context, I think this was a lot of like beginnings for people and their families, and even like listening to activists who had been like talking about this radical care work for a very long time. Leah Piepsinessa-Marasna is like someone who has been talking about like care work, radical care work. Thinking about like Adrienne Marie Brown, thinking about like Mia Mingus, oh my God, like people who have been like shouting from the rooftops and disability justice movements and like trying to like call us all into different kinds of relationships of care so that we don't get to like really dangerous places together, has been something that I think maybe the radicality is about the scale of it. I don't know. Maybe the radicality is just the reflection of how far off we are in some ways of like, I think that I am in a care-centered practice. And like, if I forget myself in that practice, that also means like, ooh, like I'm doing something where I'm deprioritizing myself in the community, which is something that I think often happens with BIPOC artists who are like community culture workers, is that we often like draw this circle around community that we're not a part of, like we hold ourselves outside of. And so one of the things that we were really trying to practice was like, can we also be in that circle? Like we can center other people, but like, can we also have our embodiment, like our like needs, our contributions, like can all those things be a part of this circle? So like that's what we're bringing to each time we come together. So it's that presence, it's also that support system, it's the ability to say no, like we've taken on too much this time. Mm-hmm. And I think that's about the expectation too, is like really like, who's setting these expectations, right? Like who set it? Are we, are they, are us? Like who are, yeah, and are, where's the room for the humanity in that? Like where's the room for like, we all have expectations and then we all have to be like literally just like in our bodies. And like, if our bodies can't do it, then we have to have some like, we have to have some like real reckoning moment with like those expectations. And also, like you said, Hussein, it's like sometimes those expectations, they aren't from like us, maybe they're from a generation above us, or maybe they're from like an oppressive systemic level. And so it's like, really, like, who are we listening to? Like, where are the narratives coming from? And I think that was one of the things that we really had to kind of break down. And I think that's also a forever journey, honestly. Sorry, I went in lots of directions.
I'd really love to add on to that. Oh, sorry, Ceci, were you gonna go? Okay. I really love to add on to that, especially like, you know, pertaining to balance, pertaining to seeing yourself external, the like externally from the community, and also like, you know, expectations. Like I said before, don't mean to sound like a broken record. I really went like deep into this work, like knee deep into, you know, my junior year of high school, which, you know, some people say was like the craziest year of high school. And, you know, I was on Zoom, so everything was intertwining. Our Rabban was intertwining, our IRJ was intertwining, and my schoolwork was intertwining. And, you know, when it comes to those expectations, you know, me being having been like an honor roll student ever since I was in high school, ever since like from eighth grade, of course, you keep those really high standards for yourself. But I guess in a way, I realize, you know, the multifaceted of life, like how you can have so many different layers, like multi-layers. But I think in a way, as a part of it, as you guys said, like, you know, something that we forget is to take care of ourselves. And I think that's something that's, I'm even still learning now. So I'm not just talking out the side of my neck. like something that I'm still learning now as a 17-year-old, and like something that's so important, because, you know, I kind of had to like sit back and really think to myself. And even like after, it's like, yeah, you know, like, oh, Shervina, the activist, Shervina, the artist, Shervina, the scholar. But it's like, yeah, you're also Shervina, the 17-year-old that needs a really good amount of sleep. Like, you want to get this work done, you need to be rested, you need to be able to get the work done. How are you gonna get any work done running on empty? And it's like, that's something that I still need to repeat to myself every day, because, you know, like, sometimes those expectations can be external, but you can also internalize them. And I think I'm learning to cut the cords. I'm learning to not internalize those, realizing that only, you know, we as artists, we as a collective, we as a community can know what we've been through, can know what we're going through, can know where we've been, where we are, where we started, how far we're going. Because I mean, look at us, we're all going so far, like, come on now. And it's like, you know, can't nobody tell me I'm not a scholar, can't nobody tell me I'm not an artist, can't nobody tell me, like, come on, like, at this point, no one can tell us anything. Like the only voice that you really need to listen to is like yourself. And that's something that I've really learned to, you know, value as of right now. It's something that I'm learning right now as I was doing this work with this community. Like, you know, there's so many different artists, so many different projects that I've seen, you know, people that have the same vision. Like something that I found so beautiful was seeing a project and seeing how much it spoke to you, especially the youth. Like, that was just something so beautiful and something that made this work all worthwhile. So it's like, I remember there was a time where I had an RIRJ meeting, but I was also in school in the midst of it. And I had to switch between Zoom meetings, kind of like a cartoon episode of when, you know, they would like switch between different places and wear different fits, like do their hair different. And I was like, Shervina, why are you wearing one hoop earring? Weren't you wearing like a dangle or something like that? It's like, I'll be right back. Gets off the call, like, hi everyone, hi Perpetual, hi Chandra. but you know, it's the humor in it all, but you know, it was all worthwhile. We got it done, we're here. Yeah, we made it happen.
So beautiful, Shervina. You are one of the people I need to listen to. You are speaking truth and knowledge and power. In the spirit of transparency and in the spirit of care, for everyone. One of the things we talked about as a group was potentially taking a short break about an hour in, take a stretch, get a glass of water, maybe do what only you can do for yourself. How do we feel, team? Should we take a few minutes, 4 minutes, 5 minutes? All right. Beautiful. So everybody here with us in the living room, we will take a break for 5 minutes, share more of our playlist, and we will be back at 6:14. 6:14, is that right? No, six, whatever 5 minutes is. See you soon. Thank you.
Scary to me, I ain't got a never gun, never stash to the funds, I just got myself. Still, I'm a passionate son of the work being done to defund your wealth. Okay, look, call this prophetic. As long as I'm living, you know I'ma get it. Fought for them cameras, y'all made us regret it. So now it's your pockets, you shredding the lettuce, we shredding. Quick, fast, camera flash, show your ass, show your badge. Lose your job, run it back. Quick, fast, camera flash, show your ass, show your badge. Lose your job, I'm with that. No peace, we know the story of police. Breaking in and entering through.
Welcome back. Welcome back, amigos, amigas, amigexes, mi gente. Is that a good break? Good stretch? Good. All right. Welcome back. That was so rich. So much resonance around. You said something. Everybody said something, but the where are the narratives coming from? Where are the narratives coming from? Kamaria, you mentioned that. Thank you for that. We were on this question of the balance and surge of capacity and responsibility to community, and you know how we push ourselves to expand scope and how we adapt to our own desires for growth and more, but also have to check ourselves. Again, so resonant. And there was a question in the chat from Lemurchi. Thank you for that. And I wanted to kind of bring that into this idea of our capacities and responsibilities to community and to ourselves. And the question was, what was your bottom line that you wanted participants and or the public to take away from the experience of your projects? And did your projects arm others radically? I feel like there's a connection with that question and this sense of responsibility, care, wellness, desires, and then being open to all the steps along the way. So, I would love to, anyone who hasn't shared in a bit want to share about that. More rich, fertile ground.
I can go feeble here. A few things. To backtrack a little bit in terms of where we pushed to expand scope or size, we had all the intentions to be done at the end of the school year in June, and we finished in like mid-November. And so that wasn't on purpose. And because of a combination of the young people themselves being like, I am not gonna do this in the summer, so. I am done. And we were like, say no more. We're not going to force that at all. Because to be honest, yes, I also feel done. But for whatever reason, we felt the need to continue. And I don't know if that was because of bringing in this new question of how we wanted the people that we were working with to feel. I can't say for sure that the young people that we were working with left the way that we wished that they did, just because of maybe it was us putting on extra work on their plates that they didn't necessarily like want. Maybe it was because the young folks that we were working with, we're getting paid from other sources, not just from us. So it felt maybe more like a job versus something that they wanted to do. We're not exactly sure. A lot of miscommunication was happening, and it was very unfortunate on a lot of different levels. But we know that we definitely wanted to when the young people had left, like we felt like the work wasn't done, because that was like we were cooking and we had this meal and we wanted to share this meal with folks, and this metaphorical meal. And so when we came back from the summer, into the fall, that's when we created our In the Park series, where we took the work that we were doing with the young people, and instead of it being a workshop, we found a way to turn it into like a public event and invited folks to come in and to break bread with us. And in both of the phases in terms of the workshop and the In the Park series, one of the things that we definitely wanted to make sure that folks walked away with was this different relationship with intentionality and with their food, right? Everyone has to eat regardless of what it is, regardless of where you're from. Like, we all have to eat as a form of sustainability. And that through as a double fish sauce, we look at that moment, right, of the idea that regardless of who you are, we all have a relationship with food as an entry point. And if we are able to provide everybody with a few tools to interact with their food in a different way, then that's something that they can continue to carry with them even if we're not there. And so we developed these 5-bite recipes where for each of the bites, we invited folks to engage with the actual eating of the food in a very intentional way, and then provided like a follow-up poetic invitation or like reflection question that was that played or danced with that first bite. And so in doing that, we had these like public gatherings in parks. We brought food, we asked folks to bring food themselves, we all ate together, we had these things, and we shared out afterwards. And like, yes, this is what we were looking for, like this moment of coming together. And it's also like very difficult to have everybody eat at the same time when you're all on Zoom. Like we sent everybody like Uber Eats cards, and we're like, you know, have your food ordered by this time. And then some people will show up and they're like, I just ordered, I'm so sorry, I forgot. And we're like, cool, do you got like a banana or something that you can like do, or like glass of water? Like, let's find a way to do these things. So like those things didn't necessarily get to vibe, but we were all together, and we were like not in a Zoom room, and we were in these parks surrounded by fresh air and just community. We were like, yes, like this is what we were hoping to have happen. I'm done.
Silvina, she, hers here. Thank you, Chandra, for sharing again the question. So one of the things that I had on the back of my mind when we started the paper theater project was to make a space, was the idea of creating spaces and own those spaces to express themselves and sharing, right? It was like this dialectic of making something visible is to see others, to witness others and being seen. So that back and forth during the project was something really, it was at the core of the project, because we live in communities, and that dynamic, we experience the dynamic of see and being seen all time. And that is so important to create connection, expression, to address things, to feel that you are in a safe space where you can express whatever you want. So safety is another important thing that happened during the project, and I also had on the back of my mind, as now more than a visual artist, you hear it was about the expressive therapist, right? That was talking all time. And in connection and in conversation with the group. So I feel that one thing that people took from the project, I expected triggers at some point. So this, we talked so much about the collective trauma and the COVID-19 and the triggers of the traumas and everything, that I expected that But what happened was exactly the opposite. People ended up taking glimmers, these shiny little moments when you share something and you connect with something positive, and you can share that in a safe way where others can witness your story, right, in a safe way. So I feel that in that sense, the paper theater, project created mini spaces, these micro stages where people had the containers of the stories, but at the same time, we created a large container where everybody shared the story with the group. And that was, I think, my personal takeaway from the project, right?
I'll jump in. These reflections totally resonate. This is Mariona, by the way. And on my end, I would say that film is super expensive, super demanding, super stressful industry. It makes you feel, or at least I have always felt like each piece, each work needs to push your career forth within the confines of this industry. And you need to get into festivals, get program, et cetera, right? So maybe there's part of the immigrant complex here of feeling like you cannot afford time for experimentation, for contemplation, for rest, and make those actual radical parts of your practice. And that you need to be basically like super efficient and produce within this machine of whatever industry you contribute to, right? So I think film in this case is also an industry that loves to exoticize stories that perpetuate certain stereotypes. So in order to have what I deem a successful project that challenged those narratives, I wanted to make sure that the film was super on point, not only creatively, story-wise, but also technically. Quality, integrity were there, et cetera, right? So going back to the question in the chat, I, at the same time, wanted to provide this healing, considerate space for all of the cast and crew involved. And then being on a tight timeline in this super linear way, like we were saying earlier, and needing to have this final product by the end of it, I feel like something had to give, right? Something had to compromise with, you know, limited resources. And that ended up being me as the director. And like Shervina mentioned, I think it was Silvina, I'd only realized this at the end. Like I was realizing it as it was happening. I'm like, okay, this is taking a toll for sure. The project started as with a much less ambitious vision, but as we, you know, gathered resources and kind of thought of ways to kind of honor the story and the theme, it expanded to end up being a crew of, I think, over 20 people and a cast of 8 actors. So again, part of the budget was supposed to be dedicated to self-care, right? But the work in itself is so heavy. And if you wanna, for me at least, and this is kind of a question for everybody, like, help me out, how do you do this? Like, if you want to prioritize the team, the community that you're working with these limited resources, slim budget, in this case for a professional film, it, for me at least, what ended up happening is I had to end up covering a lot of roles in the production. For the film, I served as director, producer, EP, writer, stylist, and also for the other side of the production, I ended up producing, directing, filming, editing, color grading, doing sound, and styling the live event while pregnant. So I just wonder what I could have done to kind of achieve a better balance. And I've had such a hard time reconciling what the industry will accept as far as quality standards, reconciling the fact that as artists serve as kind of a bridge between the unknown, you know, the honest, the truth, and we remind people of kind of their humanity, their existence, their liveliness, but we also have to pay bills, right? So it's that fine dance between doing the work and being honest and considering yourself within that scope of work, but also it's the harsh reality of all the impositions that we need to still navigate as contributing members of society, of consumerist society, right? So I think to go back to the question and wrap, the film was meant to arm the audience radically, but what changed for me was understanding that it needs to arm those who take part in making the art just as much radically, including myself too, right? So, and as Hussein was saying, because what are you really, like, are you your work? Are you the finished product of your work? Are you the process? Or are you also a human that needs feeding and rest? And, you know, like, where do you land in that equation? And my question would be, what does it take, right? Because I feel like RIRJ gave me the permission to practice wellness, and I immediately bypassed myself and gave that permission to my team, because that was what was truly important for me. Or certainly community needs to enjoy this, community needs this. And totally didn't even, you know, understand that, oh, maybe that vessel also needs some of that permission, you know, and to take that and to own it. So my two cents on that.
Wow, 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 wow. Your question's making my brain hurt. This is Karen. Mariana, that's amazing. I'm just vibing with it, being a cultural artist. You know, when you talk about your industry standard, you know, I sit on my ancestors' shoulders, you know, of a long lineage of what this practice of art looks like. And how do we adapt that to communities that we're working with, you know, and is it okay, you know? And I struggle with that as well. Just, I hear all of that. And this question's amazing. And I'm wondering if we've got it about 15 minutes before we transition into sort of what's next for RIJ. How about we finish with everybody kind of thinking about this a little bit or contributing to this question? Thank you for that contribution. How do we do this?
I'm only gonna add questions. I'm not gonna provide a solution or the panacea. Don't look to me for that. I just want to share that for our collective, we decided to take a year of rest at the other end, on the other side of this grant, which happened to be the largest single grant amount we'd ever received, and like the largest project, the largest scale of project we had ever attempted. And in some ways, okay, couple of things. One is, I wish that we could be able to see ourselves as people who can like dream and scale really big, and that like we're worthy of that funding and support, and whether we are able to do all the things or not. Like I feel like in some ways the intention of our project was, for me, like a chance to actually like deepen my practice as an artist, deepen in a way that like I'd never given myself permission to like kind of like go into like these leagues of like what is a longing that I have in connection with community, and just for like Black, queer, and trans people. Like a longing that I have is that like we see each other, and we see each other being like honored and loved and respected and like alive in public. Like I just want aliveness for us in public, right? And I think like art can articulate that so beautifully in a way that like I don't know how else to do. In some ways, like, so our art practice is also a community care practice, is also a healing practice, is also an ancestral reverence practice, is also like, I feel like there's like these like layers to all of our practices. that are kind of beyond a grant and beyond, like, you know, like how we have to kind of like propose and speak about our work in the world. So in some ways, I feel like the RIRJ, this moment gave us like a window into like a possibility. And I don't want to, because we didn't end up doing all the things, like, I don't want to simply say like we didn't end up doing all the things. I want to say like we inherited like a shit ton of systems that are actually, talk about necropolitics, talk about like systems that are here to like actually like disintegrate us. And yet here we are creating, here we are connecting, here we are nourishing and nurturing, here we are doing all these things. And like as human beings, we do have to make choices of like where that energy can flow. And I do understand that as people who are cultural workers, oftentimes we bypass ourselves. And it's not that we bypass ourselves because we don't care about it ourselves. I think we bypass ourselves because we care about the we so much. Mm-hmm. We care mm-hmm. about the we, and we care about like demonstrating the we mm-hmm. so much. And I also think that like, we also live in a culture of neglect, like massive neglect for us and our communities, right? So we also have these practices of self-neglect too that are a part of our culture. So it's kind of like, we're trying to like create things, but we're also trying to unravel things. And we're doing all these things. And I don't think it's a practice of perfection. I think it's like a practice of simply practicing and trying to like experiencing this and then reflecting and seeing what happened. And like, Mariana, like what you said, like not even knowing until you get to the end. And then, and you were growing a human the whole time. Like I wasn't even doing that. You know, like that's incredible. But the one thing I will say is that like the acknowledgement for the rest and the need for rest, I had no idea that was going to be the outcome. Mm-hmm. But I think it's like a really beautiful outcome that came out of this, where we simply asked ourselves, what would a well-rested, unbound bodies like look, feel, and sound like? What would a rested, like queer, trans, Black collective, what would that be? And what would the work be that flows out of it? And I don't know, but I think it we're like getting to, like when we were talking about before, like the radicality, like getting to the radical care, like the next level, we're getting to like deeper levels of that. And I think it's like, well worth it in a place where we're simply not, it's not like we're not like purposefully not trying to line up all these resources. Like we're literally building the things and trying to feed ourselves and trying to birth humans. And like at the same, like we're doing a lot. So I'm just here to complicate it.
Wow. Thank you for that. I don't really know how to follow that up, but I do, one thing that kind of, I think it's important to say is like, yeah, we said that we were going to take a year of rest. Are we resting? Not so much. I'm just gonna be real mm-hmm. and transparent about, like, are we doing huge projects? No, but are we still kind of like overextending ourselves? Yes. Are we still doing like projects that, you know, its scale, the time scale, the funds to do the work are this, and we still do this? Yeah, you know what I mean? Like this is.
But the loop's getting tighter. The feedback loop of like interrupting.
I think it is. And I think it's like also kind of crashing on us, right? It's having to, it's making us kind of like really rethink and practice other ways of being. And as well as like leaning into a practice of refusal. And we can refuse these types of systems. We can refuse these ways and structures that say in order for us to be valuable, creative, cultural workers, artists in practice, that this is what we have to do to ourselves. And if we understand ourselves as a part of the community, then we're doing that to other folks too, mm-hmm. like indirectly. Mm-hmm. And so like really like feeling that tension and that grinding of the gears and the smell of like the metal of like what, of when that happens, when that tension happens, when that refusal happens, and when that kind of like moment of like release of like, even if we don't know, right, what the next thing is or like the better way to be, that this is still something that we're searching for and that we're asking our ancestors for guidance for, that we're talking to each other about. Because I don't know how much will change if we continue to keep doing the thing that we know we shouldn't be doing. You know what I mean? And if others continue to keep doing the things that they know they shouldn't be doing, like this, these are the moments. These are like these, this is like the fodder, right? This is that we need to become, and in the practice of becoming something else, so that we can create a different world for other creatives, including ourselves, right? While we're here, as well as for those who come after us. Washizo.
That's so silly.
Phoebo.
You go.
No. I'm tired of my own voice. You go.
I will say only a very small and humble thing. One of the things that I have to learn to do more is to listen. To pause, especially when we are in this dynamic of being like a cultural worker and being in communities and having all these dynamics with us. And I feel that it's not an answer, but at least it's something that I am trying to practice, which is to stop at some moment. Maybe it's a micro moment. It's not like I have to be in a transcendent state of my no. It's just like pause, observe, and listen, right? So this observation, inner and outer observation, listen, listening and outer listening, active listening of what is going on in myself with others. I think that everything is so connected. It's not that it's happening to me or this dynamic are only about others, right? It's this like back and forth all time. And I feel part of this work is about that. It's about to know how to be together. How to be together, right? Listening to each other, taking care of each other, understanding what is going on. And I feel that each one of us can understand and feel that, right? But we have like to make the space again. Have to learn how to open the space, stop, and maybe to see, oh, okay, it's maybe, yes, I have to take this path, or maybe I have to listen and stop and being silent and receptive and just to be a channel, right? So, yeah, that's my 2 cents. That's your turn, Phoebo. Thank you.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing, and I'm glad you said words first. Phoebo. It makes me think of two things. One, I've been saying no to a lot more things, and being more intentional about what I am putting on my plate, but I still don't feel rested. And I'm realizing it's because it's not just for me, it's not just saying no to the thing, but what am I replacing that time with? There's a lot of, I think a lot about habits. I think a lot about routines. Our habits, like each of the small habits that we do, like cast the vote for the identity that we want or that we have. And for a long time, I think I had an identity of someone that just needed to do stuff. And so I was constantly doing stuff so that way I can feed that identity that I was having for myself. And now that I'm trying to do less and rest more, or at least rest more, and the things that I am doing
being able to be just have more life around it, I'm realizing that it breaks down into like such little small things that then add up, right? Instead of waking up and checking my phone, I need to find something else to replace that with before going to bed and you know, doing what I was doing before. I need to replace that. I need to replace that habit, that routine, with something that is actively bringing me joy or actively feeding me in the ways that I want to be full. And I, you know, shout out to small joys, shout out to stretching, shout out to like fucking drinking water. I've drank more water in the last month than I have in my entire life. And it's just those type of things that I think can be very easily dismissed, because for someone to say like, yeah, no, drinking tea changed my life. Like, really, drinking tea? You can drink some tea? Like, but no, like that, the act of boiling the water, right? Of the act of seeping the tea, the act of holding that cup, right? All those little things add up into something that matter. And so I think a lot about what are the, yes, shout out to rituals, right? Like, what are those small little things that we can do before something that we know we have to do? We know we have to sleep. So what are the small things that I can do leading up to that? I know that when I wake up, I know I'm eventually gonna have to, like, I guess get dressed. I guess at some point change my clothes if I got it, right? But like in that process from when I wake up until when I've decided that my day has like started, what are the things that I am doing? And I invite everyone to think about that for themselves as well, because that's all we can do.
Thank you all so much. I want to bring up something that Nia Holly, one of our beloved cohort members, shared in the chat, which is that land and plants can be our greatest teachers and relationships in all of this, in terms of resting, care, and being in a different way. And then she later said, even a houseplant. So thank you, Nia, for that. And also something I've heard a lot this evening is this idea of small. And yet I often like to say seemingly small, because those smalls are everything. The way that y'all described the seeming smallness of relationship, of care, of love, of water, of a hello, of no matter how seemingly small, it is the stuff of everything. So. Much love to and with all of you, and for everyone here in our living room this evening. I feel like we could keep going, and we will in different ways. I hope that we can consider us all stardust together. Thank you for that, Bashizo and Kamaria, stardust together. And in that spirit, may the energy, the sharings, the insight, the love, and the care that everyone in the conversation has had today, but also those of you here with your questions and the whole RIRJ artist community, and that's a big community, that's everyone on this call. Many, many multitudes of gracias and thank you. Appreciate you all very much. And with that, want to pass it to Cara Elliott Ortega, and we will shift to ask and answer some questions about what's next for Radical Imagination for Racial Justice. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thanks, everyone. I'm Cara. I'm the Chief of Arts and Culture with the City of Boston and a part of the RIRJ team. And wow, huge thank you to everyone for sharing today. Really appreciate having this space for reflections and wisdom from everyone, and also makes me think about all the time we spend trying to figure out what our group meetings were gonna be, and clearly we should have just all been having a conversation that whole time. So this has been an amazing process, and over a year of learning from all of the amazing artists and cultural workers who have been involved with this program, and 3 years, maybe more, of working with Ceci and Chandra at Mass Art, who have been really amazing partners, along with Dunamis and many, many, many others, as Ceci was saying, everyone on this call and beyond, who helped shape this work. So we wanted to just take a minute to talk about what's next for this Radical Imagination for Racial Justice program in Boston. And anyone who's heard us talk about it knows that this has been a really, really, really iterative process and a journey, and how we can ourselves, as members of institutions, as facilitators, as artists, as community members, be more radical and imaginative in how we support this work and support BIPOC artists in Boston. And a lot of that came up today, I think, in hearing everyone talk about their work. And Ceci mentioned this as well. You know, we're also always trying to figure out how to not get stuck in replicating the power dynamics, how to give enough space and time to process and relationships, and also how to not create silos. You know, how do we move this as a resource outside of the kind of grant maker dynamic into something that is really held by the community that it's supposed to be serving. So I'm really, really excited that we're developing a new partnership with Design Studio for Social Intervention to help us pilot a different approach and something that's truly kind of an experiment in how to do this differently and not just kind of repeat what we did the year before. So I wanna invite Crystal and Kenny from DS4SI to share a little bit with us about what that's gonna look like. I'll bring them up right now.
Hi, Crystal, you wanna share the PowerPoint?
Or
you want me to just start talking and you put it up?
Oh, here we go. There we go. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for sharing your insights and wisdom. It was such a beautiful conversation.
I'm Kenneth Bailey, he, him series. I'm one of the co-founders of Design Studio for Social Intervention. We've been doing socially engaged work in the Boston area and all around for about 15, 16 years. A lot of you guys are old friends. Good to see you all. And I'm really excited for this next partnership that we're going to embark upon with RIRJ.
And I'm Crystal B. I'm the Creative Civic Design Lead at Design Studio for Social Intervention. Really excited to be here with you all and see some familiar faces. And I'll pass it back over to Kenny.
So the studio is, as it says here, an artistic research and development organization. We've been doing a lot of work trying to codify how to go about engaging communities in radical imagination, and have been trying to figure out how do you help communities world make for quite some time. And out of this work that we've been doing, one of the opportunities we have now with RIRJ is to create a community space specifically designed to help residents imagine new worlds.
And so something that we're proposing, or something that's going to be created at Design Studio for Social Intervention at our Upham's Corner studio, is the Design Gym. And we're really excited to welcome you all to participate in the space, co-create the space. So a little bit about what it is. The Design Gym is a place where people can come to learn about what we mean about world building. Something that I heard in the conversation a lot is that the world as it is does not center care. A lot of our public spaces are designed to exclude, to divide. So we need new structures and new systems that work for more folks. So how do we collectively imagine those things? What sort of new arrangements and orientations can we bring into being and into life? Something that we can taste, touch, try, see, share, and interact with. So that's really the idea behind the Design Gym, that it's a space for us to co-learn, to
to bring these ideas into the physical realm and really prototype them and try them out. And who's it for? It centers BIPOC artists and communities, intergenerational community organizers, leaders in various capacities, RIRJ past and future grantees and collaborators, all of you. We'd love to invite you to the space, spatial justice collaborators, which include In Public, Festival, Homestead Now, Fairmont Cultural Corridor, and others. And also anyone who wants to design some sort of change in their community or in civic life. And we can go just to the next slide. And so quickly, I wanna go through these tiers of engagement. So there's different ways that you can kind of interact with the design gym. Kind of tier one is you drop in, you check out the space, you have a tea with us, you converse, you meet other people, or maybe you attend an event. Another tier is you sign up and take one of the classes or series of classes, or maybe you're teaching a class. And then tier three is you take a semester long civic design course. And this is a course that we're developing right now, which will run in the fall and in the spring. And we'll provide resources, tools for you to really prototype and try out and learn about civic design and world building. And then level four, maybe you already have an idea, maybe there's another idea, or you wanna keep walking out an idea that you've developed in RIRJ, and you're making, testing, building, prototyping this project with mentorship and support from community, resources and tools from the studio, that sort of thing. Go to the next slide. And so we'd love to just do a really quick call to imagine with us. So the Design Gym is a space for artists and organizers to connect, learn, make, and dream. So if you were gonna go to the Design Gym, what would you wanna do? And if you wanna share something in the chat, we'd love to hear from you. Could be anything, dreaming as big as you want. Do you have anything to add, Kenny?
No, no, thanks. Okay. I think you did a great job.
Cool, awesome. And we'd love to keep in touch. So one of the things that we're currently engaged in is Reparations Lab. So this is a flyer for Reparations Lab. There's a voicemail project where you can call in and share what does reparations mean to you. And our colleague Joelle Fontaine is the lead on this program or on this project. And the next event will be hosted at Design Studio for Social Intervention at Upham's Corner on July 30th. And just a little bit about Reparations Lab, it's a partnership between King Boston, New Democracy Coalition, Black Mass Coalition, and DS4SI that explores the overarching theme of three elements: harm, repair, and justice over seven areas of harm, which are education, housing, wealth, transportation, infrastructure, criminal justice, health, as it pertains to reparations in Boston. And so the Design Gym will also be utilized as a way for attendees of Reparations Lab to imagine and test out what reparations could look like over the seven areas of harm. How could we collectively design a new city that is more just? How are we honoring the stories of the past, but also creating new narratives around justice, repairing, and healing? That's one thing, one way to kind of touch and engage with this new Design Gym, as well as through this project of Boston Reparations Lab. Also, please, if you'd like to keep up to date about these events and more during the summer, we'll probably do some events that also welcome folks in for this Design Gym idea to test it out, to experience it. So you can sign up for our newsletter. There's also a Google form. We'd love to invite you to co-create and share your ideas around what this Design Gym can be, what resources and tools you're looking for as artists that are engaged in this work, or what would you want to share? What kind of knowledge and expertise would you want to share with your community? Anything to, oh, nice. There's things in the chat. Ah, this is awesome. Yes, we're definitely saving the chat. So thank you so much for all the ideas. Thank you so much.
So thank you so much, Crystal and Kenny. Thank you for those kind of amazing sketches of what the future is to look like. But also, I think all of you've heard tonight that iteration, deep listening, deep care, and also knowing that the destination that we might have in our head at the start is rarely where it ends up going. But it takes courage to walk that kind of a walk, right? And so we're gonna lead with courage, we're gonna lead with trust, but please join us. And there's some amazing opportunities that you'll start to see in the chat. Definitely go to the City of Boston Mayor's Office of Arts and Culture. There's a lot of grants and opportunities that are coming out. I do believe that there is the Olmsted Now Parks Equity and Spatial Justice Grant that is due next week, May 27th. We are definitely building out this space with Design Studio. We're so excited about building that space out with you in the future. And we also want to give another big thanks to Dunamis, who held it down for us this whole year with all the technical support. And also, we got a potty, we got a little retreat, a very relaxing situation for the artists, because self-care is real, wellness is real. But oftentimes prioritizing it is elusive. And so it's a practice, you know, bit by bit. And also just thank you to all of the artists who shared tonight and also the ones who didn't share but were here. It's been quite a journey. As I think we all know, you know, 2-3 years ago, this was before COVID, right? And so all of the project ideas were to be in person. All those ideas were different from how they actually played out, because everybody had to be nimble and responsive about, oh, I wasn't thinking I was gonna engage my community virtually, but actually, how do we turn this into an opportunity to come into people's living rooms? And I also want to say thank you, all of you, for allowing us into your homes, hopefully into your hearts. Thank you for dropping all that knowledge and also dropping tea. The tea was hot. I took notes, so thank you so much for that. And I think we are just about out of time, but I think, DJ, if we got enough time for a song, go ahead and get your dancing on, even if it's in the chair. We about to play tunes, play out, put any questions you want in the chat, any comments, and we'll just play out. And thank you so much for being here. Appreciate y'all. Congratulations, everybody. Thanks for being here.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
This is how we do it. This is how we do it.
This is how we do it. It's Friday night and I feel alright. The poor.
Alright,
I know you got to move. Come on. Come on. Come on. And I turn it up. Designated driver, take the key to my truck. Get the shawl because I'm faded.
Thank you for my family being here. Thank you, Esther. Thank you, Alex. Thank you,
Cole. Thank you, Cole. Tonight, the summertime skirts and the guys in Canile. The gangbangers forgot about the drive-by. You gotta get your groove on before you go get paid. So tip up your cup and throw your hands up and let me hear the party say, I'm kind of buzzed and it's all because
this is how we do it.
South Central does it like nobody does.
This is how we do it.
To all my neighbors, you got much flavor.
This is how we do it.
Let's flip the track in the old school band.
This is how we do it.
Go to ImagineJustinBoston.org for more information.
Check out
the virtual exhibition.
From here to there, if you're an OG Mac or a wannabe player, you see the hood's been good to me ever since I was a lowercase G. But now I'm a big G. The girls see I got the money, $100 bills, y'all. If you were from where I'm from, then you would know that I gotta get mine in a big black truck. You can get yours in a 6-4. Whatever it is, the party's underway. So tip up your cup and throw your hands up.
I see you singing, Alex. Go ahead, sing to us. Come on, baby.
I'm kind of buzzed, it's all because
this is how we do it.
South Central does it like nobody does.
This is how we do it.
All my neighbors. don't screw back.
This is how we do it. This is how we do it.
Some sense of justice like nobody does. Nobody does. YNBSCC.
This is how we do it.
I'll never come back on an old school.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Sharina.
They both Montel make no money and life no. And all they said was 6 feet he stood. And people thought the music that he made was good. Deliver DJ and Paul.
Thank you.
He came up to money, this is what he said. You and OG are gonna make some cash. Sell a million records and we're making the dash. Oh, I'm buzzing the club.
This is how we do it.
Sound central dancing like no.
Go ahead, Napoleon.
Julian,
come on down.
This is how we do it, okay? Okay.